And now it's time to talk about the black holes in the cosmic classroom. This is one of the favorite topics every time. So if the core left from a star is massive enough, not even the neutron degeneracy pressure is capable of keeping that star from collapse. And the star collapsing itself, becoming what's called a black hole. So the black hole, it's gravity's final victory, right? If the core of that's left behind from a star has more than 3 solar masses, it will continue to collapse forever in an infinitely small location in space, infinitely small and infinitely dense. We cannot directly observe a black hole because nothing can escape from a black hole. If you get too close from a black hole, you fall into it, all right? But we can observe things falling into the black hole and can learn from that. We can measure the mass of a black hole, for example, by observing what's falling into the black hole. So the black hole is a very strange object in which a lot of funny things happen because of this this enormous density. Now, what we usually refer to as the radius of a black hole is a location in space. There is nothing really there special. If you were to visit, there wouldn't be you wouldn't notice any difference, except that you would never be able to get out of there. So if you look at the at my slide here, if you're here on Earth and you throw a ball up, the ball will go up and will come down. If you throw it fast enough, it will keep going up, right? It will escape from the Earth. It will keep going up. So there is a velocity that if you throw something with a velocity greater than that, the object will escape. That's called the escape velocity. If the object is more massive, you need to throw it with a faster velocity. If it's more massive, the velocity needs to be faster and faster and faster until the gravitational attraction is so strong that you need to be able to shoot something with a velocity that's bigger than the velocity of light, bigger than the speed of light, to be able to escape. So that location, that position away from the singularity, away from the black hole, is what we usually refer to as the radius of the black hole, the event horizon of the black hole, because there is nothing, we can never observe anything inside that, because light can never escape from a location inside that. So the event horizon is what we usually refer to as the size of the black hole. Nothing can escape from it, not even light. The size of this event horizon is extremely small. It depends on the mass of the black hole, and it depends linearly. So a 10 solar mass black hole has a radius of 30 kilometers. A 1 solar mass black hole has a radius of 3 kilometers. And so on. So it's 3 kilometers for each mass of the sun. So if the sun somehow, if you were able to compress the sun into a very dense object, you would need to compress it in a region with a radius of less than 3 kilometers. And the whole thing would collapse in itself. And that would be the radius of the black hole, the event horizon. Once the material falls into the black hole, you lost any information that you had about that, about it. You don't know if it was an atom that came from you, an atom that came from an elephant, an atom that came from the table. You know nothing about it. You lost all the information about the atom. The information that you may retrieve is the mass, because it's adding to the mass of the black hole, and you can measure the mass by measuring how fast things are going around it. You can measure the angular momentum because the black hole is rotating, and you can also measure the charge if it has any charge, but black holes are usually neutral. But other than that, there's nothing else you can know about the black hole. But again, keep in mind that when you see a black hole, what you're really seeing is not the black hole itself, it's the stuff falling into the black hole, okay? Now, when dealing with black holes and things of such enormous density, the Newtonian theory of gravity doesn't work anymore. Okay. In that case, we need to use the theory of general relativity, which is a new theory of gravity proposed by Albert Einstein. So general relativity must be taken into account, must be used every time you're dealing with an object that it's either very near a strong gravitational field, or it's being very highly accelerated. Its velocity is changing a lot. That's what it means. Now remember that gravity is a form of acceleration. So what general relativity is really saying is that when an object undergoes a high acceleration, whatever, if it's gravity or any other kind, funny things start happening to it, okay? That we need to take into account. And that are not intuitive at all, but are very, very fun to look at either way. So Einstein showed that massive objects will deform the space and time around it. So he proposed that space and time are together. We don't usually experience time as something that we can change, that we can move back and forth. We can only go in one direction in time. But the rate of passage of time, according to general relativity, does not have to be constant. Time may pass more slowly for someone away from a big gravitational field and faster for someone near a gravitational field. So the clocks don't need to agree. So what's meant by space-time, it's nothing more than space, the three coordinates, x, y, and z, that we usually deal with, right? The three dimensions in which we live, plus the time. So imagining how those dimensions change with time. So this is called the space-time. And the massive object will distort the space-time. The sun, for example, distorts the space-time around it. Now, this diagram is hard to understand because you're trying to represent something in four dimensions, in two. So the way I'd like you to think about this is, imagine that you're a little person sitting here in this rubber sheet. You would fall faster if you were right here, right? Than if you were here. So you would be more accelerated here than there. So that's what this is trying to say, that the acceleration will increase near the massive object. So this here is the space-time near the surface of the sun as it is today. It does, you know, the sun distorts the space-time. If we could shrink the sun and keep its mass the same, the space around the sun, far from it, would remain the same. The acceleration that you would feel sitting here or here would be the same. But as you move closer and closer to the sun, the accelerations would be different. Now, imagine that instead of just shrinking the sun to a small size, you could shrink the sun all the way to a black hole, make it disappear. What would happen to the sun? What would happen to the Earth? Excuse me. The Earth is going around the sun. What if for some reason the sun would just disappear, become a black hole, keep its own mass, not lose any mass or gain any mass, not explode if there was just a hand that would go there and crush it in a small enough size to become a black hole? What would happen to the Earth moving around the sun? Nothing at all. The Earth would continue moving around the sun. Just the same, because the sun, the Earth is far away enough that it doesn't matter. It feels the same gravitational attraction, it's the mass of the sun nevertheless. It's true that it will be cold and dark, but you would die for a different reason, because it would be cold and dark, not because you would fall into the black hole. So if you were to keep anything into your mind about black holes, is the following. Black holes do not suck as far as you keep a safe distance from it, all right? You need to be extremely close to a black hole for it to grab you and pull you into it. So we'll talk some more in the next video.